Now, now. Oh, yeah, here I am. Yeah, sounds just like me. It looks just like me. It is me. Well, it is good to be back. So last week I took a Sunday off and attended Oskaloosa, and we had our pie fundraiser for our youth group, and so I had the joy of leading a boys' small group, and so Andy had a little competition between life groups, and so my group, one of the moms made a peanut butter apple pie, and we picked peanut butter apple just because my wife makes peanut butter pies for the auction, and she makes apple pies for the auction, and I thought, what better combination? So you know what I've been doing all week? I've been eating on a peanut butter apple pie. So it was good. So I would suggest that. And we looked it up online, and it's right there, and it's pretty simple. But man, was it good. Small pieces, because it's really rich. Yeah, slivers. It lasts longer with slivers. So this week, I want to talk about the impact of people and the difference that people make in your life. If I were to roll back time back to 1979, and, you know, that was right after Jesus came out of the grave, for some of you, I was a junior in high school, and so we decided at church we were going to start a quizzing team. And so one of the couples in our church, one of the ladies, kind of like Chris and Jennifer, decided to take on that project. And so their names were Ricky and Teresa Daly. And I can still see and hear them in my head. Teresa was a skinny little redhead, and Ricky was a farmer, and so we just got to hang out together on Wednesday nights and Sundays and Saturdays, and so my senior year of high school, from fall of 79 to May of 1980, I got to hang out with Ricky and Teresa and Stanley and all those other people. But Ricky and Teresa were a huge impact on my life, because that time spent with quizzing, and I've talked about this before, that time spent with quizzing is you're hiding God's word in your heart. And you never know when those words are going to come back to you at just the right time. So a few years, I don't know how many years ago it was, I was in one of those sentimental moments, and I don't know if I saw my quizzing trophies or what it was, but I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to call Ricky and Teresa. And so I still had an old phone book from home. And so if you know what a phone book is, I can talk to me after church. I can tell you. They probably have Davis County phone books around here somewhere. And so so I looked up in the old phone book, and here's Ricky and Teresa Daly, and you know, it gave all the information back then, the address, the phone number, and you could use any name you wanted also. I looked them up, and I gave them a call, and I just thanked them for the impact that they had on my life. So there were a couple from church that had a huge impact on my life. Most of you, all of us have parents. And your parents, our parents, are a huge impact on our lives. Some say I look like my dad. Now, my dad was 6 foot tall. So I got the good looks, he got the height. So my mom, she was, you know, about down here, and she worked in a factory. My dad, he worked in the tire business. And so I grew up in a working community, working family, understanding what it was like to work. At 14 years old, I went to work in the tomato fields. We raised tomatoes in the part of Alabama where I grew up. And so you'd have acres and acres and rows of tomato plants all tied up on stakes. And so the fun part of the summer was getting out there with all your friends and all the we had a group of Hispanics that would travel from South Florida back to North Alabama and make the seasonal trip. So you'd get out there with the Hispanics and pick tomatoes with them and have a good time. And so that was kind of the community that I grew up in. And so I was fortunate to get to spend a lot of my time with my mom. My dad worked all the time. He worked 67 hours a week all the time. And so he was always at work, and if I could go to work with him, I would, but I spent a lot of time with my mom. We'd go fishing, we'd work in the garden, and so my mom's impact on my life has been huge. Sense of humor-wise, she and I are a lot alike, and so she was a huge impact on my life. There are times that my wife says, "You act just like your dad." I don't think she means that as a compliment. Or, "You're acting like your mother." Sometimes I say it to her. "You're acting like your mother again." And then I'm in trouble. Gentlemen, there are some things you should and should not say to your wife. That is one of them. So the impact of people. And here we are in an Easter season. We're in a season of Lent, and we started Lent last Wednesday, and some people did the ash marks, and some people started focusing on this Easter season. And we're coming up on in a few weeks where we'll celebrate Easter. Some people saw it as the death of Jesus, but it was really the life of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus. It was a time in life that one man impacted life for all eternity. They thought if they could kill him, it would be over and done with. Can you imagine when the last nail went in and the last hammer struck that nail and he was hanging on the cross? And as they pierced his side and he breathed his last breath, can you imagine the Jewish leaders and the Roman leaders thinking, "Okay, we've finally got this where we want it. We're finally rid of this one man who's changing all of our lives." Over the last few months really, I've been watching The Chosen with my life group. So we've been looking, and it was season one. And so we've been looking at different people that Jesus affected. And so the Jewish leaders, they weren't real happy with Jesus. So they finally thought in his death that they had won this fight. Don't you know they were surprised when they went to the grave and they heard the news that his body was not there? But then they started rumors. Oh, the disciples took his body. And then they realized he was alive. He had risen from the dead. He had overcame death. Something that held on to people in a way that they couldn't get past it. They thought death was just the end of it. And Jesus at that point started living and impacting lives for eternity. And so that's what I want to talk about today. I want to talk about impact of people. And we're going to look at John chapter 1. And we're going to read 9 verses in this. It says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through Him all things were made. Without Him there was nothing that... There was nothing was without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. So he himself was not the light, he came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. So here's the beginning of really my sermon for today, and it's in verse 6. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. So here's the beginning of the impact. God chose John to make an impact. And as you read down through chapter 1, it tells us what the impact that John had on Jesus' life. So God is choosing people to impact the world. In the Old Testament, let's look at just a few of the lives that God used. Moses and Aaron, Joseph, David. So God is impacting nations and millions of people through the lives of one person, two persons, two people. New Testament, one of the things I liked about watching The Chosen was it looked at four different people. And I want to talk about those four people. The first one that The Chosen talked about and showed was Mary Magdalene. In Luke chapter 8, verse 2, it says, "And also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases, Mary called Magdalene, from whom seven demons had come out." So at this point, the scripture is talking about how God was using some particular women, and Mary Magdalene was one of those people. As she was a follower of Christ, she supported Christ financially. She was part of his group of disciples that traveled with him. So God used Mary Magdalene. And as we all know, she had the demons driven from her. And so here's a lady, here's someone in society that we, even today, when people, if they're demon-possessed, if they have mental issues, are there particular kinds of people that we choose to keep our distance from? Or that we choose to say, well, how can God use those kind of people? But God chose to use Mary Magdalene to make an impact in her community. The second person is Nicodemus. Nicodemus, man of influence. If you're going to pick your friends, who are you going to pick? Are you going to pick Mary, or are you going to pick Nicodemus? I'm going to tell you, in all honesty, most of us would run toward the Nicodemuses in life because they're of great influence. But Nicodemus was a Jewish leader. He knew the law. He taught. He had people to follow him. He wasn't real happy when Christ came on the scene, but he decided to have a conversation with him. John 3:1-2 talks about Nicodemus. Now there was a Pharisee, a man who named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher and have come from God, for no one can perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." So Nicodemus, in his leadership role as Jewish rules and regulations, he recognized Christ. In The Chosen, and we watched the final chapter, it was the last hour or so, and it was when they were leaving Capernaum. And Jesus asked Nicodemus to go with him. He didn't go. He chose not to follow. Now we don't hear a whole lot about him. We don't know where he ended up in his staying with the group of Pharisees or not. But in The Chosen, and I would encourage you to watch that. That was a group of power and influence. But God uses people in power and influence to advance the kingdom and to help along the way. The next person is Matthew. Matthew chapter 9, verse 9. Says as Jesus went from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. Follow me, he told him. Matthew got up and followed him. Let's talk about Matthew a little bit. What do we know about Matthew? Matthew was a tax collector. It's kind of like working for the IRS today. You know, if the IRS came knocking on your door, would you get a little nervous? Some people would, some people wouldn't. Can't get blood out of a turnip, right? So people didn't like tax collectors. Tax collectors worked for the Roman government. They came to you and they demanded payment. The Roman government said, I need $2, and they took $4. And Matthew kept half of it. That was just the way he operated. Matthew also went on to write the book of Matthew. So he became part of a follower of Christ and impacting lives. So far we've got a woman who is possessed by demon spirits. We've got a Jewish leader, a Pharisee, and we've got a tax collector. Now I want us to look at Simon Peter. Simon Peter is talked about in Matthew 4:18. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter, and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. And he caused them to follow him. Lay down your net, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Can you imagine? Have you ever been around the fishing industry? Ever been in a fish market? It's got a wonderful smell to it, doesn't it? So here's this guy. He's just a fisherman. If we were going to start with four people to impact the world, out of these four people, we'd probably start with Nicodemus. But we probably wouldn't pick the other three. But God chose four people, least likely people, to impact the world for him in the beginning. And I'm here today to tell you that God is still calling us. God is still calling people to impact the world for him. God knows your world. God knows your personality. God knows your skills. God knows your abilities. God knows your gifts. And he's still calling. I want to encourage you also to not be surprised at the impact that you're having in your world. Really, God, you would use me to change? In today's world, the popular name that we've heard for years is Billy Graham. If you've ever heard the story of Billy Graham, he was one man. He wasn't a man of influence, but he changed the church world. He turned it upside down. He traveled the world over, holding revivals and meetings and football stadiums to hear the Word of God. We may not fill a football stadium, but we can fill people's lives. Over the past few months, as I've looked on Grace Point's Facebook page, and it's with the sickness that's gone on in the community, and the impact that this church is having in this community, it's quite amazing. Through sickness, you can impact someone's life. Through, matter of fact, this week, the cooking group, the crew, you know, making these meals, taking them to people in the community with food, you can impact people. In sports, coming alongside them, participating in a sports program at school, you can change people's lives. The guy that you're working with in the factory, you can impact people's lives. And we kind of land on, at least I do, I keep going back to John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We, if God has impacted our lives and giving us life, as the beginning of John 1 talked about, then we in turn can give that same light, offer that same light to those around us. It may be a personal invitation. You might have to get uncomfortable. I was talking to a guy at work the other day, and matter of fact, this gentleman at work, he had a stroke. And so we were talking about him having a stroke and Jane having a stroke. And that's how the conversation started. And so he goes, oh, by the way, I need you to pray for such and such. He's in the hospital, and he had a blood clot in his leg, and he had a stroke also. And he said, but I feel a little guilty. And the guy I was talking to, he's a believer. He's a follower of Christ. He says, I feel a little guilty because I didn't talk to him about Jesus when I should have. He said, but I did talk to him about 2 weeks before the gentleman had his stroke. And so he says, I feel guilty about this. And so he put that seed in that guy's heart, in that guy's brain, before he had his stroke. So while I was off on my trip, last trip to Mayo, I didn't get to talk to Jeff, and so I'd stop by and talk to Jeff once I got back to work, and I said, so what's going on? And the gentleman had passed away. So he went in the hospital on a Friday with blood clot in his leg, had a stroke, and then died a week later. We never know the importance of our impact. Jeff wasn't real comfortable having this discussion with this guy. He said, but I felt God convicting me to tell him about Jesus. So what can we take home today when it comes to impacting people? The first thing is, you are impacting people's lives. You are changing people's lives. And I guess the question I'm going to ask us now is it for the good or for the worse? Because that's how we impact people, for good or for bad. How many people in your life have impacted you for good, and how many people have led you to make bad choices? So you are impacting people. Number two, God chooses us where we are. We don't have to be a Nicodemus. We don't have to. That's the great thing about a church body. We're not all the same. Can you imagine church if we were all the same? You know, wouldn't be a whole lot of fun. Board meetings wouldn't be very much fun if everybody agreed all the time. Number three. We will do things beyond our imagination. God will use you to change more people in so many different ways than you can ever imagine. And that's why he chooses us where we are so that we can, so that we're all different, so that we can all help in different ways. Number four, we all have different, we all have gifts and abilities. Don't ever tell yourself, I can't do this. God gave us all different gifts and abilities. Some people have the ability to talk. I'm one of those. So just carrying on a conversation. Hi, how are you? Some people have the ability to cook. Maybe it's your neighbor. Hey, I was just making some sugar cookies and thought I would bring some over to you and your kids. Number five. Here's the hardest part sometime. Go, we are called to go and do likewise. And that comes from the story of the Good Samaritan, where the leader of the law was asking Jesus how we love Christ. And Christ said, you love Jesus, God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love others as yourself. And then they were talking about the gentleman who had been robbed and beaten and left for dead. And at the very end of that, Christ tells that leader to go and do likewise. The expert in the law replied, and he was answering a question that Christ had asked him. The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. And here's what Jesus told him. He said, go and do likewise. Jesus calls us as individuals because he cares about our soul. But Jesus also tells us to go and do likewise because of the impact that we can have on people and the difference that you can make in a family, in a child's life, in a man's life, in a woman's life, and in eternity. We never know where that discussion ends, but God does. So I want to encourage you, believe in yourself that you can impact people and go make a difference. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you for your many blessings. Thank you for your love. And I pray, dear Lord, as we've taken a few minutes just to look at different people's lives, the way that they impacted people, the way that Christ impacted people, the way that John impacted the lives of others as he was the voice calling in the wilderness before Christ came. And we're able to see in Scripture where God has called each of us to love Him, but He's also called each of us to go and do likewise. Dear Lord, I pray that we would go and we would go obediently, that we would go with enthusiasm and an urgency before someone's time here on earth is done. And help us not to live with that guilt, if only I had said. But dear Lord, help us to plant that seed, because we know if we plant it, that your Holy Spirit will water it. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. You are dismissed.
Till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you. You called my name.